Welcome to the series of special webinars being organized by the Department of Media Science of the Heritage Academy to guide the students in their learning. Today we have with us our esteemed guest, Mr. Ayananshu Lahiri, Associate Creative Director, Milan Loyalinda's group. Now, I would like to request our principal, sir, Professor Dr. Gaurav Banerjee, to say a few words to introduce our guest.
As the principal of the Heritage Academy, I feel privileged to welcome Mr. Ayananshu Lahiri as our guest speaker in our today's webinar, Decoding Creativity and Art of Art Direction. Mr. Lahiri is Associate Creative Director, Millennial Low Group. He spent almost a decade in advertising and is passionate towards creative art. Ayananshu is one of the few lucky ones who could transform his passion into profession. I am honored to welcome our Chief Executive Officer of Learn Bharati Trust, Sri Pradeep Kumar Agarwal, for his continuous support, encouragement, and doing everything for making our academy a going for successful ventures like this. We also welcome Mr. Provi Roy, Director of Learn Bharati Trust, members of faculty, and my beloved students in the webinar. Ayananshu, students are eagerly waiting to listen to you. So, thank you very much. God bless you.
I would now like to invite the Dean of the Department of Media Science, Professor Dr. Madhubha Bakshi, to say a few words.
Thank you, Anubhav. Thank you, Principal Sir, for being always there and giving us the support. Ayananshu happens to be my student, ex-student, and it was my whole purpose in bringing him to the students was that design students, we have very few opts for the design area. And Ayananshu was one of those who was very passionate when he came into the master's program. But very few are able to carry it forward successfully. So to the students, it was my wish to present him so that they can emulate what Ayananshu has done and what Ayananshu is doing. He's just in the first a few years of his work, but his example can be taken by the students and they can build themselves on that. Thank you. Ayananshu, over to you and over to Shubhadi and Anubhav.
I would now like to hand over the session to our moderator, Professor Shubhajit Ganguly.
Welcome once again, Mr. Lahiri. We are very lucky and we're very privileged to have you on board. So you happen to be my senior in college, so we never met. I was in BMS when you were in the first year of master's.
Oh, I never knew that.
Yeah. I was in the first year when you were in first year in master's. Anyway, so okay. I have a request, you know.
Sure. Tell me.
While pursuing with your session on decoding creativity and art of art direction, I would like you to explain a point to our student that when we talk about creativity, we think about creative freedom, right? So when it comes to creative freedom, it means we can do whatever we want. But on the other end, if you want to capitalize that particular creativity, then you need certain norms. It might be norms of the company for which you are working, or if you're working as a freelancer, then you should follow the norms of your client for whom you are working, right? So I want you to put a light on this point, how to keep a balance between creative freedom and capitalizing the same. Over to you, Mr. Lahiri.
Okay, so I'll come to that part where I'll explain. I have a couple of campaigns that I wanted to show to everyone, which I had worked on over the last couple of years. So I'll pick up this point when I'm presenting that section. So basically, my entire presentation for today, it's an hour, I think. So yeah, so I'll start with the presentation maybe. I can start, right?
Please go ahead, please.
Yeah. Okay, so quick question. I hope everyone knows what this is.
Yes, sir.
So this is the Sistine Chapel. This is the house of the Pope in Vatican. And I'm pretty sure everyone knows the masterpiece that is being showed here on the ceiling. So the Sistine Chapel is full of these paintings by Michelangelo. So I just want to start this presentation with how to decode a brief. Like this is really important while working on art, because the brief is the first thing that comes to you. And if the brief is not pulled in correctly, or you don't understand the brief, what happens is you end up working on something which is actually not on track with what your client wants. So the brief is basically a proof of what you have understood from what your client's requirement is. So, okay, so this is by Michelangelo, and let's assume that his client was Pope Julius II. Okay. So what would the brief have been? We'll just try to decode like what the brief could have been by the Pope, Pope Julius II. So this could have been an example of brief, the first brief that he could have given. Please paint the ceiling. So is it a good brief? Is what my question is. Okay, there is no one that can answer my these things, right? Everyone is on mute.
People, you can write your answer on chat.
Okay. So now this could have been a brief, but then is it a good brief? It's absolutely not. Please paint the ceiling. I can just randomly book a guy from Urban Clap or maybe a bro for you will come to my place and paint the walls with normal color. He just asks me what color do you want. He'll paint it yellow or green or black, whatever. This is not a good brief. What could have been an example brief number two? Please paint the ceiling using red, green and yellow paint. This is even worse than the one that I showed before. This is basically, you put a restriction to the person that, okay, you can only use these three colors. And then he does not have a direction, as in he does not know what he has to paint. It can be one random guy, even me, like taking up a ladder, going on to Sistine Chapel and painting the ceilings in red, green and yellow. But that wouldn't have been a masterpiece. So what could have been the brief that he had given? The next brief. So this is even worse. We have got terrible problems with cracks in the ceiling. Can you cover it up for us? This is like the worst of the lot. Because he does not, Michelangelo has no idea what the problem is. He'll just find cracks. He was a painter, he was a visionary. He's not someone who will paint cracks and like cover it up for the restoration. So we'll get on from this. This is better. This could have been what brief Michelangelo had been given. Please paint biblical scenes on the ceiling, incorporating some or all of the following: God, Adam, angels, cupids, devils, and saints. So this gives him a fair idea of what is expected of him. He has the creative freedom. He knows what he has to do. Like, he has to include all these elements: God, Adam, angels, all biblical scenes, which he can make. But then, was this a good brief? Like, I have given four examples, but none of these would be a brief that would explain what he has to do exactly and still give him scope to have his creative freedom. So the best brief that Julius II could have given to Michelangelo could have been this. Please paint our ceiling for the greater glory of God and as an inspiration and lesson to his people. This brief does not give him any restrictions. It does not tell him, okay, you have to use red, green and yellow. It does not tell him there are cracks, you cover it up like a normal household local painter would do. It does not like confine him on using only 3-4 elements to draw it. This gives him freedom to do whatever he wants because it's for the greater glory of God. He knows that he has to create a masterpiece for his client and post his client, which will go on to inspire a lot of people and give them religious and emotional freedom and confidence on the religion as a whole, the story of God. So this is exactly how a brief has to be. Now, this is very like example wise, but then a proper brief will also have your target group, what your target audience is, to whom your creative will be relevant, what is expected of from the client, what are the kind of hurdles that the client is facing with the product. Maybe suppose, for example, I have, I'm selling maybe a snack, and my hurdle is it is not fried, it is baked, and people, there are so many brands that are selling baked chips, like 2Yum and all, like there are so many. So my hurdle is my audience does not know that my brand is also like 2Yum, but then it's better because it's baked. So that is the brief. That are the kind of questions that you ask before starting a project. What is my target group? Do I use bright colors? Do I use pastel colors? Do I use grayscale? There are so many campaigns that happen in grayscale. I'll give you examples later. Questions like, where is this going? Is it for print? Is it for TVC? Is it only for digital? Is it going outdoors also? So those are the kind of questions that you have to ask before starting on a project. If you start on a project and you go back to the brief once you are midway through your creative, that is a problem. That is where you will get stuck, and then people will start questioning you. At least at an agency level, like the kind of environment we work, it's really fun. And you have the creative freedom to do whatever you want. But the thing is, these are the few points that you have to keep in mind and then develop on these so that you have your creative freedom. But then still, you keep on track with what your client wants from you and what is relevant to the audience, which will, our ultimate goal is to make sure that the product sells, whatever it is. Even if it is not sellable, if it is a niche product like maybe a Rolex watch, I know that at the end of the month, I won't have a lakh of people buying a Rolex watch. It would be around 200 people only buying a Rolex watch, their monthly sales. But then still, I'll have to make sure that whatever art I'm coming up with for the client helps in showing Rolex. I'll go back to this slide. For the greater glory of not God, but then our customers. And that will inspire our customers to buy Rolex and be brand loyal. So if I can take an example other than Rolex, Apple is a brand that is inspiring. It has become a status symbol now. Why? Because Apple has a certain kind of art direction to it. So all your outdoor creatives that you'll see from Apple will have this small line. I don't know if everyone has noticed it. It is, the art is just one picture on a huge 40 feet by 30 feet hoarding. It will have one small Apple logo on the left hand side and a small strap line on the right hand side bottom corner, which will say shot on iPhone. That is it. They don't put anything else. That is what the brand is about. It's minimalism. So they have figured that minimalism works for the brand, and that will inspire people, their customers, to buy or own whatever products they will come up with. Apple fans, I'll tell you, like, I won't even look at the configuration. If it's a new product, I'll go and exchange my old product, get the new one. Because that is how I relate to Apple. Everyone else will have different brands that they will relate to. Okay, so brief is like your Shah Rukh Khan movie where it says in the background, it reverbs, lele, lele, lele. It's like that. Brief will go, it will echo in your ears like brief, 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 brief. When the briefing session is complete, you don't have any more questions to ask. That is exactly when you start working. You don't go back on a brief after you have started working on something. Okay. And it is very, like, it is not ideally like a suitable situation that people from a department other than art will come up to you and tell you that, okay, this was on the brief, but then the, what you are doing is in a different direction. You should not do this. That is really bad. Like, your brief should be one document that you can throw on others' face that, okay, fine, this is what you gave me and this is what I've made. I think this is perfect. And if you don't have confidence, I'll go and present it myself to the client. This is how it works. Okay, it is not this serious, but then, yeah, it all happens in a funny way in agencies. So, okay, now we'll go on to a slide that, okay, now this one is basically the process that, this is a simple process that you need to follow. It's very generic. So first is when you review your design brief. So you get your brief, you ask questions, you get to know what is required of you, what will work for the client, and what will work for your audience, target TG. And then you have all your pointers noted. Then you go to a step where you research and you discover other brands, your competitors. So if suppose I have Apple as my client and I get a brief that a new iPhone is being launched next year and I have to work on it, what do I do? I'll go and check what Samsung is doing. I'll go and check what brands like Xiaomi is doing. And I'll find out what the premium phones, like how they come up with content for their premium phones, because iPhone is premium. If I'm marketing, I'm making art for a campaign that is talking about iPhone SE, I'll go and compare, do competitor study for phones that are cheaper, that are like phones like Vivo and Oppo, because iPhone SE is not premium. So you'll have to figure exactly what your brand or your product stands for, and you'll have to study other brands accordingly. You cannot start working on iPhone SE and look at references, art references from phones like Galaxy S7 Plus and iPhone, what iPhone 11 has done. You cannot do that. For iPhone SE, you have to be in that same zone. Because the world, the art world for every product, for every product range, based on its price, keeps on changing. A 10,000 rupee phone art will look different. A 50,000 phone will look different. A 1 lakh phone will be very different from what others are doing. So you do research and you discover ideas from Google randomly. Just look for like very basic keywords like phone ads, premium phone ads, gray phone ads, silver phone ads, things like that. Then you sit with your larger team, you brainstorm. So step two, where you research and discover, is basically where you come up with your own ideas and references and you keep it to yourself. When you move on to step three for the brainstorming session, you sit with the larger team, the content writers, your planners, account directors, and then you brainstorm and you start sketching them and telling them, okay, fine, this is what I came up with. These are my ideas. And it might roughly look like this, and you sketch concepts. If you cannot sketch, it's fine. You just draw a box and write image on it, draw a square and write logo on it, and show them, okay, this is my layout. These are the kind of images I am looking for. And this is what you can write. If you don't want to go into copy, it's fine. You can ask the content writers, okay, this is what I meant with my layout. I need something like short on iPhone, maybe. Or maybe I want to show that these images are all not professional images. We have sourced it from crowd, from our customers. And for example, this idea, okay. Then you get your copies. You have your final draft of what has to go, what the legalities are, and you start building on your concepts. You know that, okay, fine, I'll have to show one phone, I'll have to put one copy, one logo, and you make sure that your phone is your hero product on the creative. The phone has to be the hero, and the copy is something that will support it. So if my phone, I'm showing my phone as like a huge phone, half of my phone on the left hand side, the copy has to probably put out a RTB that says best in class camera, 42 megapixel camera to give you such clear pictures that this, we can vouch for the picture that we have used here. It's shot on iPhone. That is your concept. And you start the art for it. You build on your concept. Then once you're done with the first draft is always something that you carry forward. The first draft will give the route to the client and your internal team what the final art is going to look like. So from step five and step four, this is a loop. You keep on repeating this. So step five, you'll get feedback. Come back to step four, build your concept in a nicer way, in a better way. Go back, then iterate your concept, discuss with the larger team, come back. So this keeps on happening. This is, I should not tell this here, but then this is sort of an endless loop that goes on in advertising. But yeah, good things come out at the end. When you finish the entire project and you release your artwork, as in you tell the client that, okay, this is my final thing. These are the ones that you had approved and this is what best I can do. And you tell the client that, okay, fine, we go ahead with this. That is how you build on your art project. Okay.
Sorry, Mr. Lahiri, yeah. Sorry for the interruption.
Yeah, tell me.
You do have a deadline, right? You said it's an endless process, but you still have a deadline.
We have a deadline, but what happens is, so these deadlines for like these kind of steps, no, are involved 80% of the time we are working on campaigns.
Okay.
For deadlines like social media or maybe a small project that happens, maybe suppose it's just an event, maybe a Britannia event that will happen. So I was recently working on this Britannia event, which is called My Startup Contest. So what they do is they ask women, working women or like housemakers to give their business ideas and send it to Britannia. What Britannia does is they'll select 100 best ideas, business ideas, and they'll fund 10 of them. They'll give 10 lakh rupees each to the top 10 ideas that the jury will select. So that is like a huge campaign. But this campaign has been planned. This happened in February and this we were working on since October end. So the deadline there was a constantly changing deadline, as in the first lot of creatives had to go out on January, then February while the event starts, we'll have to go do. And those kind of deadlines are flexible. But in smaller projects, like I have a store launch today, not a store launch, an experience center is just a section of the store and it is just for 50 people. Those kind of projects will have deadlines, which will be, so those really happen fast. It's not like a 4 month window that you get to work on those kind of projects. It's usually a couple of weeks, 15 days. So what happens is the first four steps happen really fast. So you get on a call, the briefing call, which happens usually for 1 hour, and you are being told that, okay, next to next Friday, this has to be presented. And that's it. You know that, okay, next Friday, by hook or by crook, I'll have to do it. And that endless process somehow fits into that 15 days. Okay, so whatever happens, whatever the deadline is, the endless process is there. Maybe you work 8 hours a day, or you work nighters, you pull in all nighters or get up early in the morning. It's all to make sure that whatever you are giving is the best that you can do, and it looks the best, and the client will be happy for it. And the only thing that you like while making art is you know that once you see your creatives outside, no, or once it's released or you see it on TV, whatever TVCs you make or print ads, you should be proud of it. You should be able to pull in like call 10 people and tell that, okay, fine, like look at this. This is made by me.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So that is something there is a sense of pride, and that is always the driving idea that will be there. So that is why whatever you make, like making, creating an art will take maybe a day. But then if you spend 5 days before it to think about it, you know that whatever you have done is best to your capabilities, given the time, the deadline, of course, the deadline that you have been given. Okay, so that is there. What also I'd like to add here, what I do is usually these things, no, I have figured, like if you make one creative and you just send it, no, what happens is they are bound to come back with changes. So if we have to be maintaining a deadline, what I follow is, if I have a 5-day window, I'll probably try and finish off the creative, the first creative, in the first 2-3 days, but then I'll not send it. So what happens is, if Monday I'm being told to make something and Friday I'll have to send, I'll keep the creative ready by Wednesday. And what I'll do is, I'll keep it to myself. I'll work on something else. I'll revisit that creative on Thursday, because I know I still have 1 day left. Like Friday morning, I'll have to send the creatives for approval. So I'll keep 1 day buffer and I'll relook at the creatives on Thursday. And I'll forget about the creative on Wednesday. Wednesday, like 6 o'clock, I'll shut my system. I'll forget about it. I'll work on something else. Thursday afternoon, I'll probably reopen the file and go through it. Like, okay, this can be made better. Maybe I'll have a cup of coffee. I'll roam around. I'll play with my kid. Then I'll come back to the system. I'll look at the creative. Then I'll feel like, okay, like what if I do this like this? So deadlines are basically like things that are slapped onto you, as in, okay, this is what you have to do by this time. But then you can always have a way around. As in, if you have 15 days, you can always push yourself and make the creative in the first 5 days, ponder about it for the next 5 days, then send it to the client after 5 days with revisions which are yours and not your larger team. So basically, there are how we figure deadlines are. So a client will give a deadline. What we do is, we work backwards. So if the client has given 15 days, we'll work 10 days for the internal team, for the entire team that is the agency team, the content writers, the planners, account directors, and the art team. And in my head, being a designer, I'll give a deadline of maybe 7 days. So I know 7 days, after 3 days, I'll have to give it to my colleagues. And then after 5 days, they'll also ponder over it for feedback. And then it can be sent to the client. So deadlines always have to be calculated backwards. If it's impossible, you directly go up to your servicing team and say that, okay, fine, I think I need more time. And no one kills you for that. If it's not like, if Friday is the launch and then I don't give it by Friday, then it's a problem. But then it's a campaign. I'll be honest, there is a lot of buffer, as in, we are planning Diwali campaigns now. So you can like imagine the kind of time we have in our hands. Yeah. Okay, we are working on a Tanishq Diwali campaign, which is like 6 months from now. And we don't even know if Diwali is going to happen this year. Absolutely. But still we are working, like brainstorming on ideas. We are having like 10 o'clock, 10 p.m. calls at night on Saturdays. Because it's Tanishq, and like, yeah, like you have a sense of pride in you that, okay, fine, this year's Diwali campaign got 1 million hits and I was the one who figured the idea. So, yeah.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. So, so that was the part that I wanted to tell everyone about, how to take a brief and how to work around it. My next section of the deck will be trends for this year. So as I mentioned earlier that we follow a lot of trends, I'll just go through the trends that are there for this year. Maybe it will help everyone else. Like whenever they are working, they can probably just like browse through these ideas and you can like, oh, I saw it somewhere. Probably we can make it. I'll also show you in these trends, I'll also show you the kind of formats that we try and incorporate in campaigns. So nowadays what happens is, campaigns are usually, they call it 360 degree campaign, which usually encompasses your TVCs, your outdoor creatives, I mean OOH, and as well as your social media creatives, like all your Facebook, Twitters of the world. So what we do is we work on one idea. So while presenting, it's of course like there are 3-4 ideas that are being presented. Once it's finalized, one idea, we start working on collateral creatives. So suppose if I do a campaign for Britannia, which I was mentioning just now, startup contest, what I'll do is, I'll obviously end up making OOH for it, like women standing, homemakers. So I'll simple creators which will have a background, one lady in front, and a copy that says that my startup contest 2, like part 2, version 2.0 2020 is here. And a small copy, register your details and like a strapline small, log into our website and submit your ideas. But then how do I make it 360? Making it 360 means that I'll have to create smaller pieces which will look the same, like not the same, but similar from the same world of art that is being presented. And it will, like for digital, we use a lot of tech these days. It's not only creative anymore. It is usually called creative tech. We do a lot of apps, games on TikTok, Twitter stories that are interactive. So there are these Twitter stories where there is a backend, there's a software backend, and it allows you to tap and click elements. So I can have options. I can have four options. I can tell them, okay, click whichever option you want. I'll show you what it means. So things like that. So it's all about creative technology, and we make a lot of games as part of a creative 360 campaign. So if I'm making a campaign for Swiggy and I say that, okay, we want to gratify the Swiggy delivery guys, we probably make a game which is only for the delivery guys. A game, for example, say maybe a delivery game, a top shot of a city where you have to maneuver your bike and pick up deliveries, drop it somewhere else within a stipulated period of time, and you can get points. It's much like your temple run and all. So things like that. So I'll show you like a couple of animations and things that are there for this year, which you can just follow. Like it will, these trends, usually if you even have a very, like a simple idea, no basic idea, this will make your creatives look far better if wherever you can incorporate these. So this has been going on for some time now, minimalist logos and simplified creatives. All this is done just to make use of negative space. The negative space is something that has been going on for the last 6-7 years. This is a recurring trend. I am sure this will come up in the trends list for the next 5 years. Whatever you do, you have to make simplified versions so that if you can use one color at least on a white background, that is your target. So like I use one color on my creative, not exactly a creative, but then on logos, maybe for digital, take brands like Coke and Pepsi. They do a lot of minimal creatives where they'll just put the Pepsi background blue and put something like a small copy, one word, which is what it is, or maybe an icon, which, and they write a wall copy. Okay, fine. They just put one smiley, as in those emoticons that we have now for LGBTQ day. They just put that icon and then just write on top that, okay, fine, this is to celebrate today for the LGBTQ community. Things like that. So minimalism. Okay. We also have this trend which has been going on since the last 2 years of continuous animation sequence. This is more to do with digital creatives. And if you have gone on Facebook and Instagram, you'll see a lot of these animations that keep on happening, as in they don't stop. They're in an endless loop. I'll show you some examples, things like these. So it does not end. It goes back, it ends where it started from. So when it again starts playing, no, you feel that, okay, fine, this is going on endlessly. There is no end to this. Then we have logo animations. So this is also something that has come up last year. We used to present logos as is, as in we make a logo, a static creative, and then we used to present it. But then now, with the advent of social media and Facebook and Instagram allowing like animated display pictures and videos to be put even on websites, the small favicons that we use, the icons that pop up on your Chrome tab on top, beside where the website name is written, those are all like animated now. You can, there are ways and means to make them animated even on websites. If you have a header where you have your home, about us, that section, and you have the logo on the left, you can always put an animated logo. So these are the kind of examples that you can do. Like, yeah, the Google Voice has, even Google has animated for voice, whatever. Google, everything is animated. Uber also, when you start your app, it animates. The Uber app animates. That is the loading screen, basically. The logo animates, then you come onto your Uber page where you book your cabs. So all these clients are now starting to put animated logos. So anywhere that you find a scope of animation, you have to, as a designer, you have to, it's your ritual, basically. Okay, I have made a static creative. It is fine. My client likes it. It is approved. But then what if I make it animated? What if I want my client to remember me after 5 years and tell my agency that, okay, he made this creative. I want him back on this campaign again this year. That is the kind of goals that you should have. Again, like minimalism I was talking about, simplified illustrations are something that... So till last year, it was flat designs. Now what has happened is it is semi-flat now. So if you see, the flat is the fox that is there on the left. This was till last year. But now what has happened is this year, they are telling us that semi-flat will work. It's called flat version 2.0, but then it basically has a lot of shadows, but then not blurred shadows. These are still vector shadows, which are your lines. So if you see the fox on the right, it is a definite partition where the shadows are, and it's of the same gray color. So you put, what you do is you make an illustration wherever you find your shadows, make gray boxes and just multiply it so that the shadows are uniform everywhere. It's not like I have one darker shadow on the right hand side, one lighter shadow on the left. Every shadow should look similar. It has to be the same shade of registration gray that you are using. If I have to elaborate, registration is something that is on a CMYK palette. The K is basically the registration color, which is your black. So it defines the color range of 0 to 100 for your intensity of the black color that you're using. The more you go towards zero, the black keeps on getting lighter and it becomes gray. So you pick a registration color, maybe a CMYK 20K, and you put it everywhere, wherever your shadows are, and you just multiply it. Also on your left hand side, if you see, we are using a lot of long shadows these days. So you can probably use these flat shadows, the longer ones which blur after a certain point of time, or you can extend it till the end of the creative. Whatever, this is also called neo-minimalism. Basically, you use the same colors for the copy and the background, and you just put the shadow to differentiate differentiate both the layers. It's very simple. These are simple plugins that are inbuilt in Illustrator and Photoshop. Wherever, even CorelDRAW, if anyone is using CorelDRAW, these are the kind of features that happen in like one click and a little bit of settings preferences after that. But then if I put a normal, like if suppose this semi was written on white on the turquoise background, it would have looked nice. But then if I make it like this, I know that 5 out of 50 people will try and use this effect, which makes me different and not like the other 45 people who are making the same thing, a white text on a turquoise background, or maybe a white text on a gray background with a normal drop shadow. So these are the things that will make you different from others. Then these are all minimal. Like, see the one on the right hand side, they have only used black, yellow and white. So only the outlines are there. Wherever there are deeper colors, they have used black, like the hairs and all. These are the kind of illustrations that are going on since the last 2 years. Even I was mentioning like what happens on websites. If you look, these are the kind of animations that keep on happening on websites. So it's all getting interactive now. It's not the age where we used to have static background. Okay, the website, you can scroll endlessly, and it will keep on showing you images on the left, copy on the right. It's not like that anymore. Like everything is animated nowadays. Like these kind of simple animations, you know, it takes 5 minutes of your time on Photoshop or Premiere or After Effects. You don't want to install Premiere, After Effects, Photoshop is the go-to guy. You open Photoshop, create a keyframe timeline, and it takes 5 minutes of your time, just like that. It's nothing. But then this, I'm sure, like I told you, 45 people out of the 50 other creative guys working around you won't be ideating like you. So if you make a creative, just look at it. Go back, have a cup of coffee, meet a friend. I know you cannot go out now, but then call a friend. Yeah, watch a movie or an episode for 45 minutes. Come back, you'll figure out these ideas. And once you figure these out, no, keep these in mind and just keep on keep on thinking about creatives where you can feel, okay, I did this for one other brand some time back. What if I can reuse this now? What if the same idea, the same animation pattern can be used here also? You just make it from yourself. Give 15 minutes extra to your creative. People will be happy around you. That is it. It's all about making people happy and telling others that, okay, fine, yeah, get your creatives done from this guy. He puts in extra effort. But then it's only 5-10 minutes. So yeah, minimalism, use of simple colors to make my product the hero. So if I look at these creatives on the left, my hero product is the chappal, the Hawaiian's chappal. And I have only used two colors, one turquoise there and one yellow background, or the blue and the orange here. It's all about using how you, like, see the right hand side creative. This is also minimalism. What we have done is, it's only like it's stop motion. These take hardly half an hour to make. It's just that you'll have to trace it, put a solid color on it, and just animate it. Put a mask on it. These are all technical terms, but then I'm sure like whoever has worked on design will know these terms. It will be easier for them to go back to their systems and apply these when they are working on creatives next time. These ones. So I could have put one original, like the left hand side picture, I could have put it in the original color tone, whatever it had, the color palette. But then if someone does it like this, what happens is these creatives start looking different, a lot different from what the actual image would have looked like. So these gradients, you see, these gradients have been in trend for a lot of, like, a long time now. These have been gradients that have been built by Apple, and it has become a trend. If you have one simple image and you put, instead of the sun, you remove the entire background, the sky, put one blue gradient from the iOS palette, and you make a circle, like a normal orange circle, and tell that this is the sun and this is how my creative looks different. It, trust me, it really looks, starts looking different, and it looks like you have actually taken an effort on this creative. These are very, 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 like, minimal, like, limited time skills that you have, which you can apply to make these look better. Okay. Yeah. Now, these are the kind of trends, like the creative tech trends that I was talking about. See the right-hand side image. So wherever you move your cursor, no, these keep on moving, her eyes. So it basically, there is a small three-line code that tracks your mouse movement, and the eye keeps on rotating, which is on a different layer. So if you use these kind of things on your websites, no, people will remember. As if people will come back to your website and ask that, okay, fine, I saw it somewhere. Oh, this was this website. And he'll refer like 10 more people to go look at your website, and no one knows, like, out of those 10 people, 5 people might end up buying things actually from the website or your product or your client, whichever, like, whatever it is. So it's all about, like, pleasing the viewer's eyes, as in flat visual elements, but then you try and combine a little real life effects, like this guy on the left, like a small teardrop falling, or this eye moving with the cursor, those kind of things. Also, with minimalism comes the concept of vivid colors and duotones, like the iOS gradients that I was talking about. What happens is, so I'll just skip all these. So these kind of colors, vivid colors, are what Apple had brought into the market like 6-7 years back with the colorful, when they launched the colorful phones. What they did was they started using a lot of bright colors, like fluorescent yellows and fluorescent turquoise colors, and they started using gradients and these weird patterns. See, this is the kind of monotone and duotones that I'm talking about. So you select one color, this turquoise color, and you start exploring different shades of turquoise, and you don't go into other colors at all. Like with the blue, easily like 01 could have been written on yellow, but then someone did not, because he felt that I stay in a monotone this thing to make my copy stand out. So I can see 01. If it would have been yellow, it would have looked nice, but then 100 other people will have put yellow on that 01. So yeah, I just like browse through these examples. This is also monotone, where you get rid of the entire color palette from an image and just put it on one color. You just slap one, whatever your brand color is. If it's, if it's a color that is green, you just make everything on green, shades of green. Your entire website starts looking green. That is how you build your brand connect. Like, you know that, okay, somewhere I see this green, or I see this treatment on green with images, I know this is my brand. Same examples of duotones and monotones. So here, if you see, these are all gradients, those Apple iOS gradients that I was talking about. The Spotify gradient is basically what Apple had used 6-7 years back. Okay, monochrome examples are these. What happens is you lighten the image and make sure it's only one single color, and your main image becomes black. So if I look at the first image, it's all black or blue. The second and third image is only blue, or so basically if you multiply black onto red, it becomes a little bluish. That is why it's a little blue, and that red, the deep red gradients, the textures that are there. Okay, so for 2020, there are websites that are there where you can follow these trends. For 2020, this color is called a living coral. So this is a trend. There are like these agencies like ENY who will do these kind of researches, where they go around and asking a lot of people, like, what your favorite color is and what would you like. So we usually call them concept cards. What happens is in concept cards, you make a rough creative, you use a set of colors, and you send it to the research agency. What they do is they show it to thousands of people, and they'll ask them like very silly questions, like, do you like this color? If you don't, what color would you have preferred? So that is how they come up with trends. So for 2020, they found out that this color is actually called living coral, but then it is sort of an orangish pink somewhere in the middle. So they found that this was the color of the year. This is going on since 2019-20 was this color. So if you want to be upbeat on that trend, if you're making a creative next time, you can blindly use this color and tell them, okay, this is in trend and I will use this color. This looks good. And I know that instead of 100 people, 1,000 people will like this, because this color is for this year. Okay. So vivid color combinations and these kind of animations. See, these are all endless animations that keep on happening. It starts from the eye, comebacks to the eye. These are a little difficult, but then I'm just showing you how you can probably get help from people and tell them, explain them, okay, this is what I want. And these will start looking better. And it will be like, oh, like, this is really good stuff. I think, but yeah. So Apple being one of my favorite brands. So Apple in 2016 somewhere, or maybe 2015, what they did was they started a competition. They just randomly asked people to revisit the Apple logo and make them into whatever they want. Like, you could have made a real apple also with a bite on it. And there were like millions of designers from across the world who started like submitting these kind of ideas. And what Apple found out was, they found out that all these designers were using more or less these kind of vivid colors, the fluorescent colors, where the yellows and the oranges are really bright. And then it almost like the colors start looking like colors out of a children's book. And what they did was they really liked it. And they built this entire repository of different looking colorful Apple logos. And what they had done was this year, beginning of this year, they started putting out these logos on their websites, on their social media handles. And they started recognizing these designers also, whatever the top ones that they had selected, no? They started putting like made by this designer, tag them on their Insta handle, and they put it out. This is the kind of vivid colors that Apple resonates to. Also with vivid color comes the kind of 3D designs that are in trend this year. So yeah, just browse through these examples. They're all 3D. Like if you don't know how to make 3D, there are ways and means to make vector 3Ds where you just imagine that your product, like the element is a 3D, and you start adding shapes on their sides to make it into a three-dimensional space. So if you have a box, you put two rectangles, skew them to their sides to make it look like a cuboid, like a square to a cuboid. That like what we had learned in our art classes, like when we were kids, that is how you do it. So you start making 3D things. If you can't make 3D, it's fine. We can always ask for help. So these are the kind of animations that in 3D that happens. So if this is my website, the one that the Fender guitar, the one with the Fender guitar on the left, no? So this is really great. Then it is just like gives my, if you swipe up, it gives the details of the guitar and the guitar is on top. Yeah. Let's quickly browse through these animations. Like if you do these, no, your creative automatically starts look different, looking different and like very like different and good from the others, whatever is going on around. So this is how you should stand out from the crowd. Custom font, yeah. So we do a lot of these kind of animations where you make like this seven. There are like 1,000 ways to write a seven. So whatever your brand relates to, you make that. If it's a discount, like suppose it's my brand is called 7-Eleven. It's a really like a famous supermarket from Thailand, and there are in other countries also. What if I had to redesign seven? I could have put a percentage sign that looks like seven to say that they have the best discounts and the lowest prices from all the other stores. Or maybe I could have put a down arrow with the seven bar on top to say that our prices are slashed. So things like that. So you have to relate what you want to tell them. And you can redesign stuff like these. Yeah. Text animations again. So custom, all custom fonts. You don't download fonts from websites like the font or what the font is nowadays. You always end up making new fonts so that first thing is where they started from was you go around copyright issues. So all of these designers who make fonts, now obviously they have copyright issues on their fonts, whatever they make, and you have to attribute. It is not possible in 99 of the 100 cases to attribute. If I have a TVC, I cannot keep on writing everywhere this font that I have used is made by XYZ designer. I cannot do that. That is not possible. And why will I do that? Because I am, instead of selling my product, I am starting to sell this designer's font. So I should not do that. So what we'll do is we'll start making custom fonts. Making custom fonts is really easy. You download a font, add elements to it. Like if this beast mode font was a normal font, I just had to add splashes on the ends to make it look different. And it becomes my font. And I can vouch to the client that, okay, this is a custom font. We're not getting into trouble for this. Okay, yeah. So 3D typography also, if you're making custom fonts, you should also explore a bit of 3D fonts. These are also like 50% of the time you can end up making these great kind of 3D fonts on Illustrator plugins. You just need to download, just need to research and download a few plugins that will make your fonts look like these, like the 3D ones. If not, if it's too advanced, you can always have softwares like Maya or 3D Max, or you can ask for help. But then, yeah, like you should all like start exploring these kind of tutorials that are there on YouTube. People who make 3D designs, people who make duotone creatives, how to simply like shortcuts to make 3D text. So all these things, there are like so many of them on YouTube. It's very simple. Okay, these ones. So these ones, the moment you start using these kind of great like fonts, no?
Sorry for the interruption, Mr. Lyle. We're chasing time right now.
Okay, cool. I'll just quickly go through. Okay, these ones, animated text, liquid effects on texts, fonts that are only in outlines, nothing. Very simple, only outlines. Okay, these ones. I have shown this before, but still, like for websites and all, we can use these kind of simple Photoshop. Photoshop will do these kind of animations. It's really simple. Okay. Animation floating elements where, these are also 5 minute jobs that will start looking different. Very simple to make. Color palettes for this year, I showed you the pink color that is there. There is also a little bit of light blue turquoise kind of colors that are in trend this year. So yeah, iOS gradients again in trend, and geometric designs where you use abstract art to create social media creatives. Not, these are not for OH, not for outline branding, like offline branding. For banners and all, you don't use these. These are 90% of the time for social media creatives. Okay, so that brings me to the end of the second part of this presentation. I quickly browse through the kind of campaigns that I have done in the last year. Okay, so we were working on Prime Day, Amazon Prime Day. So I'll tell you where we started from. So Amazon is really proud of the kind of boxes, the degenerable, the biodegradable boxes that they make out of cardboard. And they found out through research that there are a lot of people who hoard these boxes because they are environment friendly, and then they use them from other purposes for storing and all. So it's all over the world, even in India, people hoard a lot of boxes to keep stuff under their beds, over the loft, wherever they'll find a place. They'll put stuff in there like not daily used objects in the box and just put them away. So what they did was they came up with these ideas of they call it the Boxtropolis world, where everything is made out of cardboard figures. So they cut out cardboards, and this was part of a research that they had done 5 years back. So every creative for Prime Day, Boxtropolis is their property. You'll not find this on Amazon normal creatives. It's only for Prime. So they make cardboard figures and shapes, and they use it on the creatives. So this is a campaign, and the campaign is always, any campaign is divided into phases. So the first phase for Amazon Prime Day is where you talk about Amazon Prime as a whole, the benefits of Amazon Prime. And you tell them, okay, if you have like Prime Day is coming up in the next 5 months, if you have Amazon Prime, you'll get extra benefits. And you'll get faster orders. Like, you pull in people, you build up your audience before your sale actually starts. That is your phase one. You have to do it before you start your actual sale. Otherwise, on the sale day, people won't end up buying stuff. They'll probably go out to Flipkart or somewhere, Myntra, wherever they'll find it cheaper. You'll have to pull in your major TG onto your website and sell them Amazon Prime, so that they know that, okay, fine, with Amazon Prime, I'll get these many facilities compared to the other brands. So for phase one, we did this. So I'll show this later. Okay, this one was basically to put RTBs in place. So basically, your main things that you, the facilities that you get with Amazon Prime. So yeah, so with Amazon Prime comes Prime Video, faster delivery, and Prime Movies. So we sold them all these three things like 5 months before the sale actually started. This was phase one. When we went on to phase two, what we did was we actually started telling them, okay, come. Like we have set up points where you can look at the sale day creatives and how Amazon Prime this year 2019 will be looking like. And if you have Prime membership, you'll get to like, you'll get an early access to the sale, which happens 48 hours before the actual sale starts. So if it's on 16th July, what you'll do is, if you're a Prime member, you'll get to know all the deals and the best discounts on 14th, 2 days before the sale actually starts. So we started telling them, okay, come to this place. Maybe if you're in Delhi, there are these 10 places, in Bangalore, like 15 places, so on and so forth. Okay, so we also did these kind of P4As. Oh, I'll not show this. This is the kind of, this was in trend last year, where this bottle cap challenge. So we started doing these kind of things where, yeah. So where we started making relevant pieces of content around the sale day, just to keep people informed that, okay, fine, the sale is also coming. This is what is happening. If you are in trend, you will also find Prime. Okay, we also did this influencer activities where we got celebrities to review products. So we did this also. These are like a lot of these that we did. And this was phase three, the final launch. So these setups we had put out of cardboard boxes across places. So airports, outside tech parks, outside these huge places in the pub places around, maybe say Park Street in Calcutta, or maybe an Indiranagar in Bangalore. So we did these kind of installations where people could go, just scan the box and find out deals that they require. These were all scannable. These were all the technology involved, where even if you see that Comicstan poster, it was scannable. If you scan that, you'll get a list of like funny shows on Amazon Prime Videos. So things like that. We did a lot of these. And finally, we came up with the TVC. This was phase three, the launch. So we launched the... So yeah, so if you look at here, like we called out all the features like dates, whatever facilities you will have with Prime Day. You'll get electronic discounts, apparel discounts, fashion, jewelry, whatever you want. We have everything. And we ended the campaign there. Okay, so this is how we work on campaigns. Like you build your campaigns in phases. I'll show you one more example quickly. This was for, so I worked on IKEA India launch in 2018. First time when IKEA came to India. This was a pretty, like, it was tough because people of India were, most of them were ignorant what IKEA was. They did not know that places like Home Center, Royal Oak, your Godrej Interio and all, they all steal ideas from IKEA. The entire idea of making space-specific furniture and solutions was IKEA's idea long time back. Maybe like 50 years back, IKEA came up with this idea of making furniture according to your space. If you have a 50-meter square space, like a room, they'll make furniture accordingly. They'll find ways and means. They'll put a bunk bed. They'll put storage behind the wall, things like that. Now all these other brands have started doing this, but then people did not know it was IKEA's. So what we did was we did a research and found out what the pain points were for customers. And we started selling them what IKEA was in phase one. As in the first wave of creatives, we just told them that, okay, fine, this is what IKEA is. So I'll just scroll. In Hyderabad, what we did before the launch was we painted all these autos with IKEA colors. So if you look here, these are all IKEA fabric. So we used IKEA textiles, decorated these things and took them for a ride. So if you see here, we did a VR integration with the autos and we showed them exactly how the IKEA products look like. So we tied up with Google Maps and we tied up with Facebook VR to put all these things in place. So these are all IKEA products that you kept on seeing. Like, if you take that, if you're lucky to find the auto, you wear that VR glass and you keep on looking around for your entire journey. Keep on looking at these IKEA products jumping from nowhere. We also did this where there is this product for IKEA, which is called the Hartha, the family Hartha, which is basically a heart shaped cushion. And it's really famous in the entire world, as in, and people did not know in India. So what we did was, before we actually showed them the product, we made a costume out of it. And then we just randomly, So whoever came and hugged the family Gharta, this costume, the guy in the costume, got a free coffee. We tied up with Starbucks and we gave them free coffee for hugs. So this is how we build a connect with IKEA and the product Hartha itself. And the Hartha is really famous all over the world in among kids. So kids end up buying, like, there are people who end up buying 15, 20 Harthas for, like, as return gifts for their kids' birthdays from IKEA. So this is how we build the connect. And here what we did was, we renovated bus stands in Hyderabad, because, like, closer to the store where the launch was happening, we renovated the bus stands. So this is a bus stand. Like, no one believed it. Like, people were surprised. Like, they were shocked. Like, the kind of reactions that we got while filming this video, we were like people were, okay, fine, am I at the right place? Did I get lost? Is this really someone's home or is it a bus stand that I usually come every day morning? So that phase two, what we did was we tried to build connect, and I just show one funny one. This one. What we did was we tried to build connect and show people how the products were different and how they made use of your pain points. So, like, this is for folding chairs that you can hang on your wall. So we made a lot of these. I can show, if I have time, I can show one more. Can I?
Yes, okay, yes, we are chasing time.
I can try sending these links later. Send all these links. Better. Much better. So he goes on explaining books and all, and then basically all these were personified versions of all the IKEA products. We did a lot of them where the products are talking themselves and they keep on telling that, okay, this is that, this is that, I have done this, I have done that. And launch was, I just showed this one, the same Hartha we did. So we did these short videos, these funny short videos. So we did this. This was basically, we used the Hartha again, where we started from, and we ended up using the Hartha to do the countdown series and the final launch, the reveal video. Okay, yeah. So we did now open like that. And also, this is me. This is the funny part that you get to do in agencies. So end up acting also like this. This is me basically. Because they lost the costume after we did the hugs, like coffee for hugs. They lost the costume. We had to remake this and then I ended up wearing it.
Wow.
So, and yeah, it brings me to the end of the deck. It's the last slide. So basically, design is something. It's a thinking made visible and relevant. So what if, like just a thought, it's not like I'm looking for any answer or something. Design should be relevant in a way that if I have a place where I store all nuclear waste products, there is this huge underground space in the US, which is a restricted space and you cannot go inside. The fourth logo that you see is the radioactive sign, which at least for, I know for the next 100 years will work. People will recognize this sign and know that, okay, fine, I'm not supposed to go here. If I tamper with this place, the entire world is gone. So design has to be something, like it has to have some insight and it has to be relevant in a way that even after 10,000 years or longer than that, a sign, a visual element, whatever it is, will be relevant. Whoever is, even an illiterate person who does not know how to read or write or look at signs and tell what it means, has to feel that, okay, fine, this place is something that I should not mess with. Or this is what this means to me or will mean to any other people around me. So that is something there that I want to sign off with, that be relevant. And you are, being an art director, you are a person that people will end up coming to visualize their idea. Whatever is in their head, if someone wants to show it to 1,000 more people, they'll end up coming to you. And because they don't have a way to figure that end result. So you are the one, you are the visionary, you are God, and your hand of God will create designs that will make people understand what it looks like or what it means to other people.
Thank you so much, Mr. Lahiri. It was a wonderful presentation. I must say it was not a presentation, it was a journey. It was a journey of a campaign, I must say. Complete amalgamation of theories and practicals. Wonderful. So we have a question from the audience. I think he's
one, yeah, sure, sure, sure.
I think he's one of the students. He is into some another name. He asks that for making designs with characters, do we need to be a good at drawing, or we can just use some stock images?
It's Shonendu, I think. I think Shonendu is asking the question.
Yeah, it's Shonendu. Yeah.
I'll clarify one thing. I am not from a definitive art background. Like, I have not been a painter most of my life. Maybe the first 5 years of my life when my parents forced me to go to painting and drawing classes. But then if I can draw, then I think anyone else can draw also. You start, basically what it takes to make character designs are, you need to know the human biology, one, and a grid that will help you understand the proportions. Like how long, like if my head is X, my hand will be 3X, my legs will be 4X. Maybe my body and my torso will be 2.5X. That is what you need to understand first. If you are using stock images, make sure that you end up customizing them to a point that it's unrecognizable compared to the original stock that you have downloaded. Otherwise, you will end up in trouble. You don't want to release a campaign and have design cops standing behind your back asking you about copyright infringement. So I should say, not double check, maybe check 100 times to make sure, show it to 10 other people. To make sure that whatever you have downloaded does not look even 80% similar to what you are presenting. And just practice, like keep on practicing. Look at a lot of artists who draw, like who will give you shortcuts. Like, there are really like nice, some nice videos, like illustrators on YouTube who give you shortcuts on drawing basic human figures with only two shapes, like rectangles and circles. So start looking at these videos. These are really simple. You just type on YouTube, you'll get like thousands of videos there. If you follow them, you'll end up making characters. Like, not being from an art background, if I can make, then I'm sure everyone else can make also.
Okay. So we have another question from Nidhi. She asked, what are the different websites that can be referred to for UI and UX design inspirations, except for Dribbble and Behance?
Okay, so you have already mentioned the two websites that are there, which everyone else follows. Dribbble and Behance are the most, like, two most important websites that everyone will follow. If not, I would suggest, like, I follow this on my own. What I do is, I on Behance and Dribbble, no, whenever I find a good UI UX designer, I look them up on Instagram. Okay, find their own personal handles, follow them on Instagram, start talking to them. You don't have to go to the extent of finding them on LinkedIn also, because you're 100%, like 90% of the time, you'll not find designers, like good designers on LinkedIn, because art people are a little carefree and careless. So they don't actually, they won't spend their time on LinkedIn and stuff. They'll probably try to brag about themselves on Instagram. That is one thing that we all do and everyone else should do, just to put it out that, okay, I am a designer, I do good designs, and this is what I mean. This is how I spend my days and how I earn my living. So look them up on Instagram, try finding them. Most of the time you'll get their own personal handles on their profiles on Dribbble and Behance only. And start, like, randomly, like, hi, hello, I found your design on Dribbble. I loved it. Like, what all can you refer me? But then, like, in reality, there are not those, like, those many of good websites like Behance and Dribbble out there. So they are the only places you can go to.
Okay. So we have another interesting question from Nidhi itself. She asked, okay, would you choose to make something that the audience needs to hear or get educated about, or will you play it safe and not risk it?
Play it safe and, pardon, not?
And not risk it.
Okay, so I'll give you an example, not an example, like situations where I end up facing this exact same question. Like, everyone would have done it sometime. What happens is, like we were talking about the brief, you get something that you have to make, like a particular line of, like, a thought which the client would like, and anything else that you present will probably get shot down. So what you do is you try finding a balance. Maybe the client likes a model in a way, like maybe a lady standing like this. So what you do is you'll find the lady standing like this, but then instead of making her wear a sari, this is just a random example. Instead of making her wear a sari during the shoot, you show her wearing probably a denim and a t-shirt. This is a very crude example, but you'll have to find ways and means to incorporate you. And, like, trust me, like, if you have a better idea than the client, which you will always have, like, agency people and art people will always have better ideas than clients. So if you present something better, the client is bound to like it. And they'll probably give you feedback, but then you'll end up mixing and matching both and finding a middle ground to present your own idea as well as keeping track with the client's requirements. It's not set in stone. It's not like my client wants it, so I'll do it like this. Maybe if it is, the project is going on for months and then you are, like, frustrated to your wits, you're like, okay, fine, let's give it like this. But then, yeah, keep on trying then.
Do we have another question? We don't have. Okay, then I would like to invite Shraddha to please conclude the session.
Thank you so much, Subhrajit sir. Mr. Ayanangsh Lahiri sir, it was an honor and privilege to have you with us. We are all inspired by your great presentation. I would like to acknowledge our gratitude to Principal of the Heritage Academy, Professor Dr. Gaur Banerjee sir, and our Dean, Professor Dr. Madhuka Bakshi ma'am, for their enormous cooperation in organizing this event. I also extend my thanks to Professor Shubhrajit Ganguly sir and Tommal sir and rest of the faculty members for their guidance and support. On that note, it is time for my classmate Anubhav Datta and myself Shraddha Das Mahapatra to sign off. Stay safe, stay well. Thank you.